whatever I'm going to do is like probably basic for some people, and some might be already knowing it. I want to cover a different session, but how many of you are into Java or like Java developers? Not many, right? So that's why I thought like maybe I do this thing. For some people, maybe it is repeat of what you already know, but it's kind of like it's kind of like an thing that you could definitely look into. So please stop me in between if you have any questions. Please ask me more and more questions, and that way we will have more learning. So if you don't ask questions, probably I'll not be able to help you. Right? And even though you might know some of these things, you might not be doing the right way. So we'll try and cover as much as time so that I'll explain you more and more things. So for that being said, so who am I and like what I do? So I'm Aravind. So I work at Elastic. So Elastic is a company behind all these open source projects like Elasticsearch, Docs-, Kibana, Beats, everything. So I am a developer advocate. I look after the developer communities, speak at the community, and work with various communities like DigitalOcean and evangelize or like help people understand Elasticsearch. I also have done a webinar series with DigitalOcean called do.co/elastic. If you go to that link, you will get a full series of Elasticsearch, Logstash, what are the things that are there, where you could go and look at it. Like I'll give you that link as well. We'll start and we'll see what is there in the log. Now, Elastic is a search company. For a lot many users, it might, for some people it might be logging, for some it might be maybe like a search engine, like something that to search. For some it could be like a security analytics or a threat hunting dashboard. A lot many people don't know how each one of them uses. Like as a company, when people start asking questions or when we go to a customer and see what they were using for, then we realize, oh, this can be used like that as well. Right? We sometimes like get amazed with the kind of thing that are, how people use Elasticsearch. So one standard or one thing that you regularly might use. So you can replace this with Grab. So Grab is a ride-sharing, ride-hailing app. So almost all the ride-hailing apps today use Elasticsearch for pairing with the driver. When you open the app and type for a location and then say book this particular car or something, get a Grab, then it goes and it searches for your entire geolocation data, like the geospatial data wherever you are there, finds out the cab and like confirms the location. So this entire thing happens within the like 3 milliseconds. Sometimes it, like it happens, takes like 2 minutes, 1 minute, depends. So almost all the ride sharing apps, for example, you take Grab, Uber, Lyft, Ozex, everyone uses Elasticsearch, like for all of these use cases. Similarly, like search anyway. So it's not just for web, it could also be used for mobile. So Yelp is a popular review platform, where restaurant review platform. Each country has their own restaurant websites and like where you can go and search for the restaurant and get these details. So Yelp is one another place where you could all of this like searching, filtering your restaurants of your need, whether you are looking for a specific dish, specific thing, like it all depends on again, Elasticsearch. It depends on like various things that you search for here.
You're saying that Elasticsearch can handle spatial data?
Yes. Okay, geospatial data, yes. So, and I don't need to explain what it is, but it's really popular probably in this region. So when you do left swipe or right swipe, so your partner matching happens on Elasticsearch. So it is a document. For you, it is like a partner, and more than that for some people. There is a detailed blog post on how Tinder uses Elasticsearch, how they kind of like suggest you the best recommendations, right? That and all you can learn more about it. So these are niche or different use cases that I really thought, didn't think that when I started using Elasticsearch myself. So another use case might be like Instacart, right? Or any sort of search box that you see where people want to search for something in an e-commerce site is mostly powered by Elasticsearch, and like there are a lot of use cases in this area where people want to, like e-commerce or retail itself is like a very huge business. Like they want to, there are a lot of business, there are a lot of money dependent on search itself. Because how many times you go to a site like Shopee and without searching just click and buy something? How many times you have done that? You go to a Shopee and like you don't search anything, just click on something and buy. Ideally zero times. Like search is the most used feature on any e-commerce site, any search. So Elasticsearch plays a vital role and important role. So this and all is about search or like finding something in the internet, finding about data. Now another thing that which is like really really interesting as well is how many of you play games? PS4, PlayStation, or like so games is like a big industry again. So some of our customers like EA or European Arts or like Activision, what they do is like they track or they collect telemetry about the game itself to find out how the game is performing in the field, like in the production, and makes it easier. So okay, I'll take a much easier example how this can be done. So anyone plays Candy Crush? Like Candy Crush? Yeah, right, everyone. Like Candy Crush, you might have tried sometime. So sometimes when you go to a level and you start playing, it doesn't get over, like it doesn't crack, right? You don't go to the next level, you keep playing the same because it's really getting tougher. So on one fine morning you open the thing and like you start playing, suddenly it suddenly goes off and like you'll be able to proceed to the next level. So there are settings or there are things that people would collect. Suppose if there are more people getting stuck at a particular level, the game developers doesn't want that to happen because they want the app to be used, the game to be played, right? Rather than making it harder for you to play. It's not a puzzle, it's something for fun, right? It's something to get like relief or like divert your attention. So that is where Elasticsearch could also come, where they aggregate or collect metrics, logs, and various stuff that you do, and they take decisions on top of it. Like they push updates to you sometimes based on the data, whatever they collect. Like that's one more thing. Now there are several. I mean, I can keep filling the slides with a lot of use cases. This is about Elasticsearch being used as a threat hunting platform, where they are Indiana University, is a university in US where they are collecting all the security, perimeter security, how people were using, or students, internally, how students were using their own resources, how they were using external resources, like how people were communicating in the site, mail security, everything, right? They want to do one big dashboard or one big thing to threat hunt the threats, insider, external as well. So this is like the niche that is like picking up very, very fast.
Is it for physical security or logical security or both?
When you say physical security in the sense?
For physical security.
I mean, in the sense like...
For Indiana University case study, for Elasticsearch.
I mean, when you say physical security in the sense like...
In the sense of access doors, logs...
Yes, for that.
Okay.
Yes. So, for example, if you are seeing something fishy happening with access doors itself,
okay.
Like so there are cases where you could do something like, suppose every day Aravind goes to the college, opens a library or some specific department door at 9 o'clock, does his work, goes out for a coffee at 10 o'clock, come back at 1 o'clock again, go off like at 5 o'clock in the morning. So if I go and come in at midnight. And I do fishy swipes, like something which is really suspicious, trying to delete some things, like there are a behavior or a pattern that's changed. So our machine learning can detect such things and like throw you alerts, block people, do a lot of things. So that is where this is generic. So this is not specific to anything. We didn't build security as such. But people started using this platform, abstract platform, and started doing things more specifically. So that is where we see a lot of pull. now there are more than like more and more companies, all SIMs, like security information and eventing management companies, they use Elasticsearch as a search engine basically. So this is what Ian is going to talk. So I'm not going to cover this. So you know TechCrunch is a popular site, right? Tech blog. The search is powered by Elasticsearch, but not the Elasticsearch that you think or we use. It is something specific that we have built, and he will talk more about it. Another interesting use case that is really, really popular. So why I'm walking you through all of these use cases, so that if you think that, like he was thinking that you mean that Elasticsearch could be used for spatial data, I said yes, right? So if you have some doubts about what you could use Elasticsearch for, that is what this is meant to, like we're covering this to explain you that what and all you could do with Elasticsearch. So NASA Jet Propulsion Laboratory is our customer. What they basically do is like collect telemetry data of various rovers. For example, one such example is, how many of you know Mars Curiosity rover? Curiosity rover is a rover that is sent on Mars for space exploration. So NASA collects telemetry data to kind of like get to bring back to Earth and then do some analysis, understand the thing, what things are happening with the rover there, about the rover, health of the rover. So the receiving endpoint is an Elasticsearch cluster. So there are several from spacecraft data like SpaceX and everything like that to something like your regular logs or normal search use case. So this thing is like a clay, like you just need to mold it to your own use case. Like Elasticsearch is like a building block. So but how all of these like is happening, right? Of big VR. So Elasticsearch has this is a Philippines user group we have, but we have around like more than a lakh meetup members. Meetup is a huge program. We have like more than 100 countries we have powered. And then the product got downloaded like more than 500 million times. It's like a bit old number. And we have like so many customers, like we have 30% of Fortune 500 customers. So like people use Elastic at mission critical use cases as well. But for all of this, search is a constant foundation, whether you are trying to redraw a map or change things, whether you are trying to do analytics or real-time analytics, everything, number crunching, everything depends on how fast you are able to crunch the data, how far you are able to present something, right? But these are the three pillars or the technology foundational things that we look at whenever we are kind of like pushing a new release or giving out a new release or saying that this is a new feature. We check for these three features. I'll tell you how it is useful really. So everyone uses search engine, some search engine, right? You might be using Google, right? I mean, I should not mention it, but actually nowadays people have different preferences. So one inherent quality for a search box is speed, right? So how many times when you typed something in search engine like Google and the tab keeps rotating, what do you think at that point? Yeah, so processing, we have an issue, or some people think it's an internet issue as well, right? You restart your router. So, but you never think that Google itself is not working, right? So the site itself has such a credibility, so you will not feel that thing. So speed is an inherent quality. If Elasticsearch is slow, or if the search is not working, then it's not useful, right? So speed is one such inherent quality that you will not realize, but it's really, really faster. So that's why people use Elasticsearch for. Another use case is like scale. Like whenever you put huge amounts of data, for example, there are like companies which generate terabyte, not even terabyte, a petabyte of data. For example, eBay ingests like more than a petabyte of data into Elasticsearch cluster every day. So they have huge amount of infrastructure across different places in the world, and like they ingest a lot of data into Elasticsearch. eBay search is again Elasticsearch. So if the solution generally should scale when you're talking about search, so that you'll be able to do anything on top of it, like you'll be able to search on it. And third and most important thing that generally, unless or until you're running a search engine, you'll not be able to get it, but it is really, really important, is relevance. So how many times when you type a particular website and your result is different, right? So it's not all the times when your search engine, you go to a particular search engine because your search results are very much relevant to what you ask. You search for an issue on a Stack Overflow, you expect that to be relevant, right? So relevance is one very important thing. So why I took time to explain this is like, every time when you think of a search solution, like you should also think of how do I configure these. Like for you itself, Elasticsearch is a building block. We are not a silver bullet. Of course, Ian would talk about silver bullets, but I would definitely tell you that if you are using Elasticsearch, you should definitely think of these three things. How do I get my speed? How do I get my scale? How do I make it relevant? How my results are getting relevant? Right? How do I make it better? So all of these things are coming from this stack. So Elastic Stack is an open source stack, and Elasticsearch is a heart and soul of everything. Kibana is on top of Elasticsearch. It's a window into the Elasticsearch. It has all the visualizations and various stuff. You have Beats and Logstash, which does the data ingestion, wherein you will be able to pull data from several sources and like push into Elasticsearch. Now Beats is written in Golang, Logstash is in JRuby, we were moving to Java. Elasticsearch is in Java, you need a JRE to run. Kibana is Kibana is written in Node.js and Angular, we are moving to React now. So React.js. So the entire stack is like open source. You would be able to run it on-prem by downloading it from our site, or you could also run it in a cloud. Any cloud, we are partnered with all the clouds, but you could also run it in Elastic Cloud, where you could deploy in a cluster and manage it, everything. As I told, like all the solutions, like these are some of the solutions that people have built, developers have built on Elasticsearch. Be it logging, metrics, or the new APM. I didn't mention about APM. APM is application performance monitoring. You'll be able to monitor what your applications are doing, like how it's responding to the user requests. And you also have various type of searches as well. Now these are some examples in the entire like Kibana, so that you'll be able to find out how this real experience looks like. This is about a log UI where you'll be able to see logs that are getting generated in live, in streaming live to this particular thing. This is infrastructure metrics, so wherein if you are running into something like Kubernetes, if your app is running in Kubernetes or multiple apps are running in a Kubernetes, so there is a joke in Kubernetes or a container ecosystem like in Kubernetes or in a container orchestration world, everything is a moving target. Like you can't target anything because it, by the time you target, it skips off, right? So you need something to track or you need something to find out really. So this thing is called Waffle Map, through which you will be able to find out the logs of the container, metrics of the container. You'll be able to see all the containers, apps, grouped by various things that you want to tell. And everything is again searchable. You will be able to search everything. So that is another thing that we have done. It's called infrastructure UI. So this completes the entire cycle. We were only talking about ops. We started with search. Now we are talking about ops and operation related stuff. So if you see here, majorly, the most important thing is like whenever you deploy an app in the production, you just don't deploy it like a Java app. You will have a UI, right? Which is in some different language, like JavaScript. You might also have, some big companies might have a particular server for APIs, like where this front-end app will talk to that APIs. So you will end up choosing best of each, right? For running your web server or something, you will use Node.js. For running your front-end, you might use React.js. And then for running your APIs and other related data services, you might use Java, right? So these are three different applications. Suppose if you have an outage or a production issue, or if you see intermittent issue, sometimes in my career, like whenever I was...
Yes.
Yeah, so you have to get the...
Exactly. So APM has agents, and there's a server which will get data from this agents called APM server. Then that server will talk to the Elasticsearch. So that's how it is.
Does it work on mobile also?
You meant to say Android kind of?
Android, yeah.
No, we don't instrument Android apps. No, we don't do. Actually, Android itself has some APM or something like Crashlytics. Have you heard of Crashlytics? Firebase, Crashlytics, Fabric.
If you're using the mobile app, by the new rating, it has that APM.
Yeah.
To choose the mobile specialized for actually.
Yeah, exactly. So I really don't recommend. I really don't recommend instrumenting apps with custom frameworks in mobile, because they might ship more data. They might kind of like your user is holding a thin form factor, and the CPU is very limited. So if you put an uncustom agent something that is really not native to it, it might start giving more problems. So you better work with something like Google's own infrastructure, like Firebase, or Crashlytics is part of this Firebase framework itself, so where you will be able to do more stuff. But anyway, New Relic has a solution as well. What we are trying to cover in this entire thing is you are able to collect logs, you are able to collect metrics, you are also able to collect what your app is done. So if you have a machine, so you are able to cover each level. Right, it's a 360 degree view of everything into everything. Right, another thing to look at is we are also looking at developing at real user monitoring agent. That means what people were doing at the browser itself.
Session based.
Exactly. So we will be able to find out a real user. Session based monitoring, not person based monitoring, but actually. It's anonymous, but you'll be able to find out how many people were having issues at cart level.
So the APM is not real time at this moment.
APM is real time.
But with the APM, you can able to get the sessions, right?
At the server level, it's not at the browser level, right? Browser level is much more.
So you don't have any apps for that right now?
Yeah, we do have RUM agent. Okay. Are you called? I didn't say RUM because. Yeah. But we have a RUM agent so that you will be able to ship out data from your browser and the front end itself, the browser.
Yeah. Usually when they refer to the stack, they refer to and they ignore the B letter. So why they don't add in the B letter to the L?
It is no more ELK. It is not called as ELK because we are out of acronyms. If I add B, it becomes BELK, right? Then APM has come, then I should add BLKA, welcome. Then I should add SIF type, which they were doing site search, app search, and then we have lot many coming. There is something on code search. We were doing something on code, right? Then if that comes, I don't know where we are going to. So now we are calling it as Elastic Stack. ELK, BLK, everything is not there. Yeah.
Suppose let's say some visualization from these D3 data. Can I put it on Kibana?
Kibana itself has D3 data. All the visualizations of Kibana is D3 actually. We also have something called Vega. We also have a custom charting library, our own charting library. We adapted React.js charts, React.biz, and we developed our own stuff. But basically, you could definitely do it. You can't put it in Kibana, but you could put it in your application. We see it's really difficult to cover everything in Elasticsearch or this company because. I don't know a lot of things everyone. Right? I don't know. I keep learning new stuff every time. It is really huge. So we will take one thin slice, which is very important, like Elasticsearch, and we'll go deep dive. But I definitely want you to ask more questions because this is very regular. You would definitely find all of this information on the internet as well. And this is what everyone talks about. But what I would want you to ask is what you might not know or what you might be doing, what you think that if I tell anything different, please stop me and ask more questions.
Yeah, question. Is Elasticsearch more of a
replacement for database is implement for database.
Replacement for AWS?
No, replacement for database is implement for database. Where do I cut the line between storing my data in database or using SSH?
So you should cut the line when you need a search functionality. You need something more than database. We never say we are a database. I'm going to come to that particular part. I'll explain you why we are not a database and like where you should cut. So when you talk about AWS, I didn't get it. Right?
No, sorry. I didn't mention AWS.
Okay.
Database.
Okay, fine. Okay, cool. So I'll explain why we are not a DB and when you should use us as well. I'll explain that.
But do you recently launched a NoSQL based expect? I expect there was a module recently when you deployed.
SQL.
SQL. Yeah.
So now, ironically, now you could run SQL queries on Elasticsearch. So I say that we are not database, but we accept SQL.
Yeah.
Why is that? I'll tell you that as well. So no worries about it. So let us go to the terms. As I told you, like it's very common. We generally interchange or keep using these terms, but I myself like sometimes find some basic concepts unexplainable. Like why do you need cloud, right? I was like not able to explain for some time. So such sort of things needs to be learned, right? So before that, like let us go into this. So what do you think is a cluster?
There's a
description. Yeah, the cluster is nothing but a group of nodes working together. Elasticsearch is a distributed system, like several distributed systems that are there. What are the other distributed systems? Distributed system, Hadoop. Yeah, Hadoop is one distributed system. You have one more distributed system that we discussed. There are several actually. You see everything that communicates together and like forms a cluster and tries to solve a common problem. You mean Kubernetes is a distributed system, right? There are several distributed systems that we use, we generally don't think of. But it is really, really difficult to manage a distributed system unless or until you master the art of it, right? And every company's constant endeavor is to make it easy for the developers to use it. For example, why do we have a Kubernetes as a service in DigitalOcean? Because deploying and managing a Kubernetes cluster itself is difficult, right? So that is why you have managed services as well. Now when we talk about cluster, cluster contains a group of nodes. So basically, each node is something that runs Elasticsearch as a process. So when I say node, so it could be a physical machine itself. It could be something like a process running in a container. So anything, like each Elasticsearch process, for me it is a node, right? That is how I basically define a node. So if we have 100 containers running in a single machine, then it is a 100 node Elasticsearch cluster. So what is an index? So index is like something that stores data. So that is what everyone knows. But why do we name it as index? Why do you think that index is named after index?
Because
you searchable.
Okay. I'll ask a more meta question, probably you might answer it, or you might think of. So when do you think the search itself has started? Search as a concept, not as a programming concept, search as a concept. Why do we call all the things to be searchable as an index?
You're looking for the specific.
From the book, at the end of the book.
Yeah, I mean, great, but I'm looking for a date, a year. When do you think search has started? A year.
Maybe BC.
Google.
Yeah, he's right actually. So search has started in 11th century. So a group of Buddhist monks, what they did is like they have a room with a lot of scriptures, and every time they want to search for something, they go in with a candle. Take 2 to 3 days, read the scripture, throw it inside. And again, they realize that this is really stupid. They want to find some easier way. So what they used to do is like they made a plaque with a wooden plaque with the chapter and the number of where the chapter, which place it is located. So they organized it. So that eventually became into indexing, indexes, table of contents for your books. or bibliography on the back of your book. So all of them is like it came from that particular time. So index is a data structure, kind of a logical home for your data. Your real data doesn't reside with index. Index is just a meta thing that is attached to something called charts. We'll discuss about that. So whenever you call anything for it in Elasticsearch, index is a thing that that is being called for. So another thing that you might also notice that is going away, if you are using an old version of Elasticsearch, or if you or your client or in your company, if you somehow download an older version, you might encounter or know this, something called types. So earlier we used to have something called document types. Index itself is a logical reference, and inside index you will have some another logical references called document types. So I'll explain you with an example. How many of you use Twitter? Twitter? No, right? Everyone uses Twitter. So you might know Twitter. So Twitter contains tweets. Twitter also contains user profiles, right? So you think of an index like Twitter. It will also have tweets as a document type. It can also have user profiles as a document type, users. So both store different types of data. So you could think equivalent of it like database. So in your database, you will have a schema, you will have different tables, right? So what people started doing is like using index as a schema, using different doc types as your individual tables, which is terribly wrong, because it has led to a potential problems in the architecture and scalability, etc. So what happened is people started doing foreign key relations between them. In NoSQL, there is nothing like relations, right? So what basically happened is these types have created redundancies. Why we are not a database? Because we don't do CAP theorem. So if you know CAP, CAP, consistency, accessibility and persistence, there is a theorem in databases. Like suppose if you take a database like CloudSpanner or CockroachDB or MongoDB, all of these databases have scores called, the score is like around 3. So the maximum score for a database that has acquired is like 2.5. Right, so we are not into that. We don't do that. And also databases does something called to tell you frankly, they do redundancy checks. If you have learned in your days when you are starting technical education, you would see something like normal forms, normalization of data. Right, there is first normal form, second normal form. They would reduce empty spaces in your tables. So all of the things we don't do, right? It's a flat NoSQL based structure. So you should somehow avoid and filter the data automatically. So types is deprecated. It's not no longer going to be there. It's not of your worry. So I took this time to explain that why we are not a database. But when you should use Elasticsearch is like, you could definitely use Elasticsearch as a primary data store, but databases does something else as well. What do you think that, how do you think that databases save data or cover disaster or solve problems of disaster management? How do you think that they do disaster management? How does databases do disaster management? Like suppose they take backup, right?
Yeah.
So now in Elasticsearch, if you haven't configured a snapshot or restore, right? If you lose your cluster, or if you there is some way, some difficult time, like you lose the cluster, that means you have lost your data. Whereas in databases, in production, it's a mandatory check. You need to enable backups, right? So you need to have a DR strategy whenever, anytime, any given time. Now I have seen startups. They don't do this DR strategy. Like you just ring up a cluster, and one fine day it's like some hacker deletes your index and like puts a Bitcoin ID and says, if you give me this money, I'll give you this data, right? So that could be potentially possible if you don't have backup. I have also seen, I'll ask you one more question. How many of you test restore? You take backup, but did you ever test your restore?
That's the main thing.
So I have seen situations where a startup or a company, they have like took backup, but they didn't test restore. They have moved on. After a year, there is an issue and they want to restore the data. It's in the older version, and they were not able to restore the data. So these are small things that we don't realize when you're running a data system. So make sure that you have these processes implemented. This will help you in the time of, you know,
disasters,
right? So everything in Elasticsearch is JSON. We eat JSON, drink JSON, sleep JSON. So all the products in this company talk JSON. And YAML is the configuration language across the board. So I'll go fast a bit. Now there are two things that differentiate Elasticsearch, or like there are how it makes, why it is elastic. Shards and replicas are the two things that give you this elasticity. So under the index, your physical data is stored inside the shard. So your shards are the primary working units. Your shards help you to do kind of like all the scalability, search, everything. When you ask queries, your shards are the one that will respond. You ask to an index, it propagates to a shard, actually. So I'll show you with a diagram what a shard and a replica does. Replica also has two uses. One is a fault tolerance, and another one is like helps you in your search queries, like helps you do more faster queries as well. Now, Elasticsearch has different types of node types. Like whenever I spoke about nodes here, so each node will do everything. Just like in a startup, everyone will do everything, right? As you start in a startup, right? Everyone is a CEO, everyone is a CTO, everyone does recruitment, everything, right? You can configure a cluster like that. Don't do anything, just keep starting instances. Everything is doable. But you could also configure the roles in the configuration file, and then like you can do each role as a like master role, data role. I mean, you can take each of these roles. Each of these done a specific thing. Coordinating nodes is like for your load balancing inside your cluster. If you are having heavy use case, like you are ingesting like 100 GB of data every day, you might want to know like what's the best way to send this data through inside. Right? Coordinating node will help you. But what covers Elasticsearch? Now, we've been talking about quite a bit of time about how Elasticsearch is being used, etc. So Apache Lucene is a project, open source project, which is a full text search engine. I mean, it's not an engine, it's a jar, it's a library. You download it and use it yourself, but it doesn't come with all the shards, distributed nature, like API out, you won't get that. It's just like a jar. And you could only use it for Java applications. So if you want to do a search for your Node.js application, you will not be able to do it. So Elasticsearch uses Apache Lucene. So we contribute to Lucene. We sit in the PMC, like the project management chair for this Lucene project. And we have a team which works to deliver more features on this thing. That's how all the goodness is coming. So when I talk about shards, so each shard is running a Lucene jar. So that's how it is. So how do you talk to Elasticsearch? There are various ways. One being something like a Postman or a curl. You can everything is an API. So all our products have APIs. So you can definitely do not use any UI. Use your custom APIs. Use your custom programming language or your own solution to talk to Elasticsearch. If we do API before UI, so before the UI comes up, you will obviously have API. So if you are not an API person, if you want something related to your language or something, we have high-level REST clients. These are wrappers around your APIs in your specific programming language. You could simply download them and use it. So that is one thing that you could do. If you are not into programming and if you are more into configuration and other stuff, you could use Logstash and Beats. It will still talk to your data or any other APIs. For example, Logstash is a ETL tool. It can do extract from various places, transform the data and load it to Elasticsearch. It can also load it to a file storage system like Ceph or probably something like S3, cloud storage, or digital ocean spaces, anything. It can do anything. So Beats, anyway, we spoke, right? Beats is like a lightweight data shippers. It will ship data from a source to a destination. So there are seven Beats at this point of time. Each Beat does a specific functionality. Now, we spoke about shards. Now tell me, what is the green ones? What are the green ones called? Green colored ones are called?
Those are masters.
That's a mark.
Okay. So these are shards anyway. What do you think the green ones are? Like, there are two types of shards that we explained.
Primary shards.
Yeah, it's called primary shard. And the gray ones are replica shard. If you could clearly see, I know that it's not really visible for everyone, but if you see that the data is distributed across the cluster, and if you think that the node 2 goes off, the copy of P0, P1, and P2 are there in the other nodes so that it is well guarded, so that you don't lose your data. One thing. And the other thing, whenever you ask a search query, the query will be propagated to across the nodes, and the shards will work on it, taking the advantage of each individual CPU. So Elastic is Elastic because it sends the search request across. It's a distributed search engine. Right, so you could deploy it in multiple geolocations and do the geo search as well, like global search as well. You can build something like that. So clear with this? I believe you are clear with both of them. Your one more point that a lot of people might not know is, like, your primary shards are responsible for create, update, and delete requests. That means whenever you put a document, you change a document, you delete a document, your green color shards, so the primary shards, are responsible for it. Your replica shards are responsible for your search requests. So that doesn't mean that your primary shards doesn't look at search requests at all. It's not like that. Whenever there's more load, the primaries and replicas take responsibilities accordingly. It will divide it by itself. Like you will have that. You need to configure these shards according to the index. So your index has these shards. Your nodes or your cluster doesn't have shards. Each index carries shards. Get my point? If you have 10 indexes, if you say like my index count is like I have 10 indexes. Each index has five shards, one replica. That means each index will have that configuration, right? I need to explain one more thing. So if you see, if I say 5 shards, 1 replica, that means each shard will have one copy of that shard. That means how many shards I will have?
Each times 2.
Which one?
Yeah, we will have a total of 3. Total means like
I have 5 shards.
Okay.
5 primary shards, the green ones.
Okay,
I have one as a replica count for
each
primary
one.
Shard. Yeah.
Okay, that's the total of 15.
It's 10.
Or the replicas, only the replicas.
So I have 5 primary shards
and
1 replica. That means, like, that's how you configure. The setting is like that. If you say 5 primary shards, 5 replicas, then it's going to be really, really big. Like, each primary will have 5 replicas. Like that. You will have a copy of it. Your replicas are just copies of this thing. So P0 is a primary one. R0 is a copy of it. Whatever you write into P0, it will come to R0. Right? Get it? So if you need to, like, think of it that way. These are important for scalability. So you need to, there's a blog post that we wrote. How many shards should I have? Right? This is an interesting question. It depends on your users. So now that if you want to ingest a document, right? Suppose you want to put a document into Elasticsearch. You call an API like that. What do you think the customer is? I'm saying the name customer. What it is? What is that name? Index. Customer is an index. Underscore doc is a document type that I was mentioning. So underscore doc is a default document type forever. So you don't need to change that, even if you don't give it, nothing bother. You will also have a ID. So you could definitely pass on an ID, like 1, 2, 3, or whatever number that you want. if you don't give a ID, we will generate it. If you give a logic to us, like generate in this series, like generate a 4 series number, blah blah blah, then we will do that as well. Like we can do all of them. Whenever you put data into Elasticsearch, it will return you something like this. You will get to see something with a lot of metadata. Now the version here is not the version like in your databases where you have checkpoints and save points. You can't roll back. You can't do that because every time we delete the data and we rewrite the data. So this is just for to know how many times the document has updated. This is just for that. Now doing every time calling an API and putting a document is really different. Like how do you really put document at a in a bulk manner? So we have an API, we have APIs for all of them. Like if you want to scroll a large result set of like probably a 10,000 documents and do a pagination, kind of like page numbers, you could, you have an API called scroll. You could also do something like bulk, either whether 5 minutes or like 10,000 documents, whichever gets filled, fire a bulk query. You can sum up all the data and like push it once. It's more efficient than the individual API calls. So I know that it is like really, really heavy. The concept is like we do 4 day trainings, Elasticsearch Engineer 1, Elasticsearch Engineer 2, which covers like more depth into each of these topics. Each of these topics can essentially take 1 hour to cover. So even mappings and analyzers, all of them like take a lot of time. So Elasticsearch is being called as like a schema-free database. Like you don't need to tell what the data type should be. Like in a SQL database, you might want to tell, you might tell that create table name or column name and what is the data type of it. Varchar, begin, end. You will need to tell that, right? If you don't tell, it will not be able to know. So in Elasticsearch, you can potentially not tell it and just put data into Elasticsearch. We generate something called dynamic mapping, automatic mapping. Now, but that yields into an issue as well. So if you think that a number, I'll ask an example. You know FedEx here? I don't know whether FedEx is there or not, but like FedEx is a delivery company, courier company, or any courier tracking company. What is a important thing for them?
What's that?
Tracking number, right? What data type the tracking number should be? I mean, if I have a 4-letter tracking number, whether it should be string, it should be long, or what type of data type it should be?
String.
Which one? String. It should be string. It's a number, right? You will.
You also have.
So what we'll explain here is like a lot many times when you put your data, you know what the data is, right? You know what it is. You know what it is used for. Like he rightly said, you don't want it to be something like a number because you will not add to courier numbers, right? You will not subtract to courier numbers. You will not do something like that, right? End of the day, you will use it like a keyword or use it like a phrase or a word to search through your database or your data store and get more details, right? So there is a data type called keyword, which will make it more faster to search. Like that is called mapping, and mapping will help you to create that entire structure. Whenever you put data into Elasticsearch, it will be indexed and made data. So Elasticsearch fastness comes in because it is getting ingested. It's getting ingested at this point of time. Now I'll ask you one more question so that we'll end this thing. So what do you think the data type should be here? Yeah. What type of data is it? What? This one? Integer? Any other guesses? Okay, so if I put this data into Elasticsearch and I don't give anything, like I don't give any previous mapping or any guideline. So what Elasticsearch would generate is something like this. What it says?
No.
Which is wrong, right? So what you said is like number. So number carries a particular length, right? -32,000 to +32,000, and long is like -2 lakh and +2 lakh. You are wasting a lot of bits, as well as you are not using it in the right manner. So potentially this could happen. So there is a mapping API like this. Whenever you put data into Elasticsearch for the first time, go and look at it, see what's the data type, and copy this entire thing, create your own API mapping. I'm not saying that learn this, just copy it, how it got generated for your property data type, change it. It will give you much, much faster. Suppose you are getting, for this, if you are getting like some 10 milliseconds, you would bring it down to 3 milliseconds. So it is like much faster. It gives you a 70% increase.
So you can also do the third party tool to do the mapping, right? The Grok. Grok is our tool.
Which one?
Grok.
GROK.
Yeah.
No, it's not. It's not mapping.
So
Grok is for structuring your data. That's all.
So it's not really mapping.
No.
So you could also use the, so right now, I don't know if already, but like, we have the geolocation coming out, but we don't have a data mapping. Do the, in order to create the mapping, we need to do the re-indexing, is that?
Yeah, so another thing that he rightly pointed out is like, if you have created this, and later point of time, if you want to change it as an integer, right, you need to re-index the data. Why you need to re-index the data? Because we indexed in a specific number, type, and a data structure. So when we assume that you will use this data for this particular thing, right? So what we would advise you to do is like decide this mapping when you are going into production. When you're trying to push the app into production, or when you're doing even POC, which is like something, you would definitely need to look at it. Like try to find out more details and get to a structure. It's just like any other schema. Suppose when you create a table, you know what type of this thing. And if you want to change the data type of a column, you need to definitely re-index the, all the column names, get all the things get updated.
What if you, like, you can't do that? Because if you have a bigger data, you know, indexes, let's say that your search data.
I'll explain your strategy. So if you, what he was trying to ask is, suppose I have done the mistake, but I want to correct it now. Right? I just don't want to do it. I thought it's there. Happens, right? You could definitely create another field with count new, like,
and
count underscore new, and send
the
data there with the right data type, right? And whenever it's possible, you could definitely remove the data. So Elasticsearch has this index management policies through which you will be able to cut the data out of the cluster and do things.
Instead of doing the indexing, is there any way that we can convert? We can copy that particular field into the same index. Let's say this here. So we have like 100,000.
I don't recommend it, even if it is there. But there is something, some way like painless scripting. We have a scripting language through which you will be able to do something. But
it's not.
All good things are painful. Yeah. I think you have got some good idea on mappings, but in the interest of time, I'll skip some of them. We'll come to full text analysis. This is very important. So whenever you are trying to do this text search or a search engine based system, your text is being analyzed. Then only you, so if I say white t-shirt, right? Somebody needs to understand and go and say pull all the documents with white t-shirt. So how does machines understand that? Unless or until you tell this is white t-shirt, or it can't be something like a straightforward match. There should be some intelligence or some sort of a knowledge inside it, right? So Lucene builds something called inverted index. Whenever you have phrases like these, like if you have winter is coming, house is a fury, all of these things, you will be able to kind of, what Elasticsearch does is whenever you put this document inside it, it will chunk the document. Again, this gets created based on your mapping. So if your mapping has the type like text or full text, this index will get created. If your mapping, say that don't index it, this will not get created, right? In your search engine, generally this gets created. By default, if you ingest a lot of text data, we'll automatically map that as a full text and then do this analysis part, everything. So if you could literally see that we are doing nothing crazy here, although like we kind of like do something different, but like it's nothing but how many times a term is counted, where the document is present. So if I ask something like winter is yours, then it will go and search for a relevant, we apply a relevancy algorithm on top of it and find out which document is more relevant. That's how we pick the document and we rank the results based on the weights. So it is like it's like a formula that we apply on top of it and then get the best document out of it.
It's the same architecture in the AI also, right? We look for the nodes. We also here you're looking for the document.
Yeah, we are doing something called document distance. We are looking for something called document distance, like how much far, for example, we also look for phrases like winter is yours. So if I say after winter is coming, so where, which is more, which document is more relevant? First one is more relevant, right? Winter and is. So we do phrase matches as well. So there are multiple things that we do, and you could change it by by using different APIs. So if you want to do which Ian would talk, if I leave some time to him. So basically, this is another thing that he would explain more, because that's more relevant as well for him. So we also do something called after putting this data into this inverted index, this table, we will further filter this data. Like suppose if you take here, if you have coming, right? Coming is a word. Come is a stem of it, and you have coming, came, like all of these derivatives of that. So we do something called stemming. Stemming is an analyzer. So we stem the words. Suppose if I have killing, like wrong word, but yeah. So kill, killer, killing, kill. All of the stem is kill, right? We keep that in the inverted index. We remove everything. We also remove the like stop words, like
each
and
like
the
each word mapping.
Yeah. So first of all, what we do is like we filter the character. Suppose if you pass on a HTML data, we'll strip off all the HTML tags and put only the individual tokens. You could also do a specific tokenizer. Suppose if your data contains colons, commas, something, we will be able to remove that. The token filter is something that I'm talking about. Like you have stop word token filter, like removing is, and, the, was, all of this as like doesn't carry enough weight in the search, right? We would also do something called synonym filter. Like fast and quick are the same terms, right? Now there are similar words. Whenever people ask for that thing, we will also pull this document. Right?
So it could be, like, so that could be something different, right? Like if you were searching for this fast, super fast, they are relevant. Like if you were. But like what you were, your example.
Fast and quick is the same name, right?
Yeah.
If I remove, if I keep only fast in the inverted index and remove the quick, right?
Mm-hmm.
So we would make sure that whenever we search for fast, we would also get the documents with quick.
But
suppose if you ask super fast, right? Then there is no super quick.
Yeah. So that
right.
won't be.
It can potentially. There are various ways that you could take this part. Whenever we are analyzing this query, this search query, it depends on the what type of query that you ask. I'll talk about queries in a bit.
Mm.
So
but this could be default, or it should be.
By default, it's all normal things.
Okay.
You need to configure.
This one is configurable.
Yeah. You can configure it.
Because if it is not, then you may get the chance of like irrelevant data. If you're like. Looking for the specific ones.
Yeah.
Sure. You do that all inside Elasticsearch, or you need to interface with external.
So everything that I talked till now is like all the things that are done by us. That means you don't need to do anything of this, but knowing this will give you a higher edge. Like you will be able to understand how things work internally.
Mm-hmm.
There is no external systems involved. Till now we are only talking about Elasticsearch. And not even Kibana or other products itself. We are only talking about Elasticsearch, and this itself like will do everything. Like you don't need to do anything. You just need to put your data. But you need to know what data is, what data type it is, and something basic things like that.
Question.
No.
Does it support wrong spelling?
Yes, we do type of action as well.
And how about international? Different languages.
Agreed. So. Now, good question actually. So now till now we were talking about only English. We support 44 languages. There's a local language like Tagalog, right? So we don't support that unfortunately. But we support Thai and some Southeast Asian languages. So if you want to like do a support for Tagalog, so probably you could write an analyzer. That might be a good chance to get hired. So Elastic is a very open source company, and you will be able to then notice all the open source contributions.
What about the language?
Yes, supported language. So there are, see, there are popular languages like which has more than probably there are several languages, 44 languages, but not all the world languages are supported. But we try to support, we try to add support as we grow. So Japanese, German, French, several Spanish, several languages are supported. In India itself, you have like probably 18 languages, and then we only support two, like Hindi and Bengali, right? So, yeah, we are making changes, and like we're trying to make it more and more optimal.
So this is another feature that is there in Elasticsearch, and which also does a specific stuff. I'll go a bit faster. So what Elasticsearch could also do is something like this, right? It could do aggregations, like it could calculate, do number crunching, group by kind of things, like bucketize the data set into multiple buckets and show you results. So there are different types of aggregations which will do specific stuff. Now, when I speak about aggregations, you could think of an e-commerce site. On the left side, you will see filters, right? You will see, whenever you type smartphone, right, you will be able to see, whenever you type smartphone, you will see Apple, LG, smartphone, Samsung, and all of Xiaomi, all of these models, right? So these models are generated automatically. Whenever you type, there will be a query called bucket query, which will bucketize the data into multiple buckets, like multiple categories. And then if you want to find out the average price of a smartphone, right, then you could apply another aggregation called metric aggregation. So which will generate what is the average Apple phone price? What is the average Samsung phone price? If Samsung has some 20-30 phones, right? Apple has some 8-9 phones, right, which are in different types. Now, aggregations will help you to do all of that thing. Left side pane, when you see, it's also called faceting. So Ian would also help. From here, it's all more search and more analytics and other part, actually. So these are types of aggregations. In the interest of time, I'll not be able to cover everything, but yeah, this is how it looks like. Everything is a query. Now, Elasticsearch has different types of queries. You could do geo queries like Grab is doing, where it will drop a net onto the map, and you'll be able to find out the cars and do it. You would be also able to do something like a match query, wherein you will be asked, if you ask an abstract query like this is a test, right, on these two fields, you will get a relevant result. So it is very abstract, like how am I doing today, right? If you ask that to Google, they will show you some results, like how is the weather, right? It's a very abstract query. So likewise, you could also do select star from where type queries, like these are called term queries. You'll be able to ask Kimchi, right? Kimchi is our founder's handle, Twitter handle. You will be able to get all the tweets from Kimchi, right? That thing, you can also do that. So there are different queries. You'll not be able to cover everything, but yeah, each query does. So what are the queries that I'm talking about, right? About Grab, thing, etc. So you see location. So there is something called geo shapes. Now if you take Manila as a map, now there are different districts or different areas, boundaries. Now what Grab does is, like, or any geospatial search use case does, is they do an envelope. They do a polygon or a hexagon, or they create these points, a shape within the map. And then they could ask, where is this shape, where this is, and they can ask something like, take my location, my phone location, and ask what are the other locations, other car type locations which are there. So all the cars are beaming locations to Grab server, to the Elasticsearch server, right? So that is how you do the search part. So each of these queries is like easy to build, so you'll be able to find out a lot of stuff. Now using this, you will be able to build a large scale architecture like this. You could either use a social media or some IoT things and push data into Elasticsearch. You could integrate with Kafka, Redis kind of systems. You'll be able to use your Hadoop data lake. If you're building a data lake on top of Elasticsearch, I mean, you have a data lake and you want to do analytics on top of your data by pulling data and do something, data science work, you could be able to do that. So everything that we discussed in the last 1 hour or so helps you to build this particular part. This is the key area. Remaining all the supporting functions which help you do more. You have any questions?
Sir, how do you protect users from seeing search results not intended for them? For example, HR employees should only have access to personal data, but marketing employees.
Yeah, I kind of understood. So, till now we spoke about open source. We did talk about how do we make money, how do we earn bread and butter, or how company is paying my salary or funding my trip to here, right? so basically, we sell a suite of extensions, which previously used to call as expect. So what expect contains is like security alerting, machine learning, monitoring, all of these extra tools. If you are using our cloud, you will get that by default along with the support. But if you want to use it on your on-prem also, you can get a subscription and do all such stuff. Suppose if you want to showcase only one index to a team,
yes,
and you don't want to showcase other things, you will be able to do that. But those comes under the commercial thing. So that is how we kind of like make money. Now till now, whatever I spoke is everything is open source. You don't need to pay anything for it. But there are few things that we monetize, like machine learning, which is like a niche that you do, like alerting on the data that's been coming. So all of this.
Can different Elasticsearch instances share indexes?
Yeah, I mean, if it's in one cluster, if you have 10 different nodes, it will share the indices.
No, what about different clusters?
It can. It's called cross-cluster replication. You can have a cluster in Singapore, cluster in Manila, cluster in probably in Tokyo.
Yes.
And then you can keep building a global search engine. You can do that for your own application. If you are somebody like eBay has cluster in Europe, cluster in India, cluster in like Singapore and Tokyo as well. They balance the search load.
We can do that all inside Elasticsearch.
Yeah.
No third party.
No third party.
Plugins.
Yeah, I mean, yeah. Cross cluster replication is a platform. So I'll take questions, but you please take note of this URL. So this URL will help you to probably get more stuff. I'll let him my colleague to kind of like set up meanwhile. Yeah, I'll definitely take questions. So this is the URL wherein you will be able to get all of these details. Now these are the links that are there. The presentation is also there so that you can go ahead and look at the presentation. ENBBL are capital letters. So I hope everyone has taken note of this drawing. Otherwise, you can ask me directly. So, we have this session is like more of advanced of what, not advanced in the topic, easier, but how you can easily build a search experience with Elastic.
Yeah.
So, and it's more of a demo rather than like PPT.
In the interest of time, I'm just going to show you a demo. So I will ask, like, how many of you have ever built a search application or search on a website? Anyone who has experience? A few? Right. So how easy was it, like?
It was tedious. I was using SharePoint search. It was very hard.
Very hard to
required,
configure and stuff.
Very technical knowledge of SharePoint.
Okay, cool. So so because we know that it's so hard, that's why we came up with a suite of solutions, Elasticsearch solutions. Basically, it's hosted entirely by Elastic, and you don't really need to. So I'll share with you. This is the architecture, right? Basically, Elasticsearch is at the bottom. We built a layer on top of Elasticsearch. So whatever you see here is just the layer, right? You don't see what's happening in Elasticsearch. Like, you don't see the number of nodes. You don't see the number of ingests, the ingest volume, stuff like that. We do everything for you. So all you see is everything up here. So I'm just going to show you how it looks like. Right? So for example, if you are building search for a website, if your website is generally in static HTML pages, you can just put in the URL here. This is the dashboard, right? So we crawl the URL, we crawl all the pages. You can name your web engine, whatever search engine. You can even choose a language. If it's in Thai or if it's in Chinese, you know, you can choose specific language here. If it's in Tagalog, then we use the universal language. We don't have support for Tagalog, as what Aravind has mentioned, because we're using Elasticsearch. And then after that,
actually, I'm curious. I have a question for that part. Is it a focus crawler or is it a broad crawler?
It's a web crawler.
So does it focus on? Can you make it crawl for searching for certain topics, or is
no? Basically, you key in the URL.
So it's a.
You just crawl.
It just crawls in that.
Yeah.
Okay.
You just crawl at the pages from there. And then this is the. This is how it looks like. When you ingest the content, you can adjust results by drag and drop. Right. So you don't need to do any coding or configuration. Very simple. And on the front end, it looks like this. Right. As you type, your autocomplete comes up. These are the results that you ingested and you changed. And then it's all out of the box. You know, no configuration needed, or no coding needed at all. So any non-technical user can start using this. But I mean, to you guys, maybe you might think this is too simple. So we have something called application search. So basically, it is for mobile applications. It is for applications that require, you know, geolocational search or, you know, very in-depth search itself. Typical use case, you know, if you are building an e-commerce website where the data source is, you know, database, you know, Oracle DB or stuff like that, you probably need to use application search. So a good example to show you is this is a demo environment that we built for this purpose of a demo.
Yeah, there is time you can. I hope it is mine if it does.
Oh, yeah.
So show it like your site search.
So this is a we call it Food Finder app. It's basically like Yelp, right? You find all the restaurants within New York, say for example. So if I type in a query here, it's a Rails app. You can see the right. If I type in a Japanese, I want to find Japanese restaurants. I'm not sure why this is showing Thai, but I think there's some bug going on. But anyway, so basically it shows a drop down of results. So it's called a result suggestion. It's all driven by an API that we have. So you can just call the API and, you know, everything is done for you. And then when you click enter, these are all the results that you see. So one cool thing is if your application requires location searching, when you move the cursor here, you can see the results start changing. So it shows you the nearest results closest to where you are searching from. How it works is basically in the back end, we have longitude latitude data, which you already have ingested to us. And we use that to execute your query. Right? You can tell your query to search against this particular longitude.
While you're moving the location, your ingestion point will be moved.
Yeah, so when you move, then your query will be executed against the engine and then you search across.
So the point base.
Yeah, it's point base. So this is an example of how you can make it into production. Like, of course, it has other use cases that you. So in the engine side, right, basically how it looks like is like this. I'm just going to show you how to create an engine. If you are familiar with Elasticsearch, then you would have no problems using ingesting data because we are using JSON. Like, so for example, I have the language, you know, universal because it's English. I create the engine. And then let me copy and paste a JSON file. Basically, you know, it's quite fast. It takes like milliseconds to ingest. if you're not keen to upload JSON file, you can use the API. We have an indexing API endpoint that you can use. So it's very easy to use. So when you go to the documents, this is how it looks like on the back end. This is all your ingested documents. Right? And it's basically defined by you, right? All these relationship fields that you have indicated. The cool thing about app search is you don't need to define any schema. So you don't need to tell us that before ingesting, you say that, you know, I'm ingesting acres, I'm ingesting location, I'm ingesting visitors, right? You can just put it as it is, and then we will do matching for you. And then you can also change the values. So obviously date established should be date, right? Not text. Square kilometers should be number, acres should be number, location should be geolocation, right? And then the rest is all text. And then you can just update. And it does a reindexing on the spot. And that's it. Right? You don't need to do an additional ingesting or anything like that. And we also have stuff like analytics, in-house analytics. So we show you, you know, what are the top search queries, number of clicks, queries with no results. So you might need to do some adjustments here, like adjusting the results yourself. We have click-through analytics as well, so we can capture how many people has bought your item, right, after searching for certain query. We can have this kind of use case. And queries with no clicks, why are they not clicking? Is it because, you know, there are no relevant content and stuff like that? And then even before you build the front end, you can test it out yourself. So if I type mountains, right, so this is how you appear organically when you type the query, right? And then from here you can see whether it's relevant or not.
This is all the backend of the Elasticsearch.
Yeah, it's all powered by Elasticsearch.
Is itself the Elasticsearch?
No, it's powered by Elasticsearch. So we build a layer on top of the Elasticsearch.
So the backend. Whatever you are building for yourself, we have built for ourselves, and like we are giving it a solution.
Yeah,
this one is basically like you print it. You can use that. This as a like, just use the API as a front end.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So basically, end of the day, you would get a script to have that search box like you were showing, right?
Yeah. So this is called reference UI, where if you need to build a front end like in 10 seconds, you can.
So you can just the.
Yeah, you can use this as a front end build. So wow. It's based on React.js, React JavaScript. So. It's a boilerplate source code, right? So basically, you can show your users how it looks like on front. So if I want to say that, you know, title field is ID plus, that's the name of the park. This is all national parks in the US. I want to filter by, you know, whether are they World Heritage sites. I want to filter by states, right? And then I want to do sorting by, say, maybe date established. You know, when was the park established? I generate a preview. And instantaneously, you can see this is the front end. A very simple front end that you can download as a zip package. You can just build from there, or just as a reference. So if I were to type maybe mountains again,
enter.
Now show the this is suggested queries, right? So you know when you go to Google, right? When you type three alphabets or four alphabets, they start to show you: are you typing this? Are you typing that? This is all API. Right?
So the package itself is wrapped. What applications do you support?
We have client libraries for I think Python, JavaScript, Java.
It also includes the APIs.
Yes. In the library itself, there's everything that you can download and you can plug it into your front end. It's very easy. So this front end itself already has the API built in for it. So this is the query suggestion API. Quite popular. And then you can click enter, right? These are the results on the front end, how it looks on the front end. So you can sort by date established. You can say I want to search for Alaskan parks, right? And then this will be filtered down into 5 results. And then I just want World Heritage sites. And this will be like 2 results. Right, so instantaneously you can show like this is how it looks like on the front end. And you can download. And then you go back to configuration, you know, you bring it back to the dashboard. You can look at the API logs, right? You can see, you know, seconds ago I just queried mountains. and then in the API request body, what is being searched against, right? And then you can see, you know, what are the things that you need to change, if there's any errors and stuff like that. One cool thing is we have easy way to input synonyms, which is basically word association, right? So for example, I say mountains. No, for example, I say my name Ian equals mountains. So I click save. Then if I were to go to the query tester, yeah. See, my name. I type my name. Then there are parts appearing. So I just associated this query to pop up mountain results. So this is very cool. If you go back to analytics, right, you realize that queries with no results. So maybe you can use this as a point to make a decision on whether to have relevant content, right? And then you also have, we also have a very easy way to do curations, which is drag and drop results, right? So yeah, go back to mountains again. So these are all the organic results for mountains. I want to promote smoky mountains, right? So I just drag and drop to the top. And then whenever someone types in mountains, smoky mountains will always appear. Either at the top or maybe somewhere around the middle or the bottom. So this is a very good way to promote results based on query. And you can even say that if someone were to type, say, maybe lake, right? Lake and mountains. This same smoky mountains result will always appear for the query lake and for the query mountains. So you can also save the queries as well. Yeah.
Those are like a predefined ones.
So you
can update them. Like, let's say you have a mountains being added.
Yeah,
you can update. That's an API, or
it's an API. So everything you see here, right? Not only is it on the dashboard, but it's also available as an API. So obviously, you might have 1,000 synonyms. Maybe you already have that built for you. You can just plug it in using the API. Or curation to your 1,000 promoted documents. Then you can just use the API. The last thing is relevance tuning. So I'm not sure whether you know what relevance means. Basically, it means to affect results organically using the fields, right? For example, if someone were to type in mountains, again, I use mountains, and then I say that, you know, I want emphasis to fall on the description, the title, right? So as I move this bar, you can see the results start changing. So this means to say that, you know, whenever someone types in any query, the emphasis will be on title, right? We'll try to match results that match the query against the title first, and then we populate them to the top, followed by everything at the bottom. The reason why you see this score one is because that was the curated results. So no matter what you type, it's always okay. Then another cool thing you can do is, for example, I want to boost values within the document. Say, you know, I just want to populate results that are World Heritage Sites at the top, followed by non-World Heritage Sites. So you can say that I want to do this rule here where true, right? Because we know that World Heritage Site is either true or false. And then as I move this again, you can see it changing. And then you can see that all the results here would have World Heritage Sites as true. Right? So this is a subtle way to say, you know, you're building an e-commerce website, you want to promote a certain brand. You can promote like Nike every time someone types in your query. Subtly promoting them. Yeah. And so this is value boosting, right? We also have geolocation boosting, which can boost, you know, parks closest to the person's location. You can boost maybe, date established. I want more recent pubs to appear at the top. And also rating as well. We do have something called rating, where it's called number boosting, right? Where you basically boost results that have, say, maybe 4 or 5 star rating, and then followed by 3 star rating. So again, API, available as API as well. So the cool thing is we have built extensive documentation for this, right? So if you go to swifttype.com, SwiftType used to be the name or rather it's still the name of the solution, but we are trying to call it Elastic App Search and Site Search. So if you go to App Search, there's documentation. Similarly, Site Search as well, right? Site Search and documentation. So documentation, they will let you show, basically you asking me, you know, what are the API calls, right? So these are all the supported ones. Then if you're talking about environment, right, you can react to those. So we have fully documented guides that you can just follow. So it's quite. There is a 14-day trial period, so you can just sign a free trial account. If you need more days, you can just let me know. My email is this is my email. And this is my Singapore number. I'm based in Singapore. Oh, you mean the examples?
Yeah.
Ah, okay.
So where it is really used?
Okay, let me show you. Oh, so what I showed you? App Dynamics.
Can you also import the data from the current Elasticsearch data into here?
Yeah, so we support a logstash output plugin where
we have an app search plugin, you can do that.
Okay, so the current Elasticsearch.
Yes.
You can extract it and you can pass it through.
I think this would be what I was telling you.
Aravind reminded me to show you an example of customer using our services. So I guess you are familiar with App Dynamics. So for their search on their website, they can easily find results because they have used site search, right? So maybe if I type App Dynamics. This is the autocomplete suggested results. Then as I click enter, this is the way they display the results. So you can see here, at the left is the faceting. So they filter by content type, right? Say I just want to dive deep into community articles. As I click that, this will only show community articles. And then you can just provide a more focused search experience for them. So even our website, if you go to elastic.co, it's powered by App Search, right? Because we have a very cool thing called the grouping function, where if you type in, say you're trying to find documentation, and obviously documentation has different versions, right? So when you look at documentation, so the filters are on the top, so you can adjust your filters anyway. Like, you look at this grouping function, where instead of showing results, individual results related to different versions, you can basically make it very clean to group it together into one result. So this is like for e-commerce again, you have different variants of shoes or different kinds of sizes, or maybe even for this purpose, right? Different documentation versions. Very good for support websites. Yeah, so this is all powered by App Search. And you're just calling the API, yeah, just to show how it looks like. Yeah, I was using jQuery JavaScript.
So.
Any questions?
Any questions?
Do
you have any questions?
So App Search is also available to download. So you could download it, and it is kind of open. So
it's
the code, source code is again like kind of open source. Like you can run it on-prem. It's in beta right now, so that you could run whatever Ian has showed you on the right. You could run it on your own infrastructure.
Question. Have you encountered trying integrating this with other companies' technologies? For example, Azure.
Okay.
Azure has
Azure Cloud Search.
Yes. Machine learning. So have you encountered integrating it with
Azure Search is Elasticsearch.
Yes.
So Azure Search itself uses Elasticsearch. They are like kind of a customer to us. So whatever they are building is kind of like something that is on top of this itself.
Have you tried integrating with their machine learning APIs?
So I mean, this and machine learning is not exactly related, but yeah, you can do something as well. Yeah. You can definitely do that.
For machine learning, I think we need more customized one. I think better to use the Elasticsearch. I don't know.
Yeah.
Maybe.
Because
this one is predefined. Everything
so,
is ready made here.
What technology could you. I'm sorry if this is outside Elasticsearch. But what technology would you recommend for OCR? I initially think that I needed machine learning for reading documents and integrating the search. What does Elastic, what do you recommend to use in
So there is a library called Apache Tika.
Yeah.
So Tika can kind of like do that OCR for you. And again, pull that data into Elasticsearch. You could use, there is an NLP plugin that is written by one of our colleagues. You could do NLP on top of Elasticsearch. Named entity recognition can also be done. You could build a knowledge graph like what Google is doing, right? Suppose you type a name, it will bring up all the history of that particular person. It can do that. And regarding your machine learning question, we are also trying to implement something on machine learning in the script type. So wherein like we try to apply a machine learning whenever people want to try query the particular search. We want to recommend show something like that.
Thank you.